This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Ultima 7, The Black Gate is the 7th installment of the Ultima series of role-playing video games, released on April 16, 1992. In it, the player returns as the Avatar, a would-be paragon of moral virtue who faces down many dangers and deceptions in order to cleanse the medieval fantasy world of Britannia of assorted schemes and conspiracies, monster infestations, undermining of crown authority, and various other machinations by hostile and cunning opponents. The Black Gate was critically acclaimed and commercially successful, being widely lauded as a high point in the series and as one of the best RPGs ever created. In an interview with GameSpot, Richard Garriott stated that Ultima 7 was the most masterfully executed of the Ultima series. He has also often stated that the game was, along with Ultima IV, his own favorite installment. Overall contents: 1 gameplay, 11 game system, 12 game world, 2 plot, 3 development, 4 reception. 5 Forge of Virtue Expansion, 51 Reception, 6 Versions and Releases, 61 Included in the Box, 62 Super NES, 63 PlayStation Portable, 7 Compatibility with Modern Systems and Fan Projects, 8 References, 9 External Links. Gameplay: Game System: Ultima 7 introduced major changes in the Ultima series. The most serious alteration is that, as far as the player is concerned, the world is no longer tile and grid-based. Tiles are still used internally in a largely improved way, where the tiles themselves are smaller and frequently grouped, but they no longer affect character and monster movement or the item placement the same way. The maps are also more visibly multi-layered, and objects and things can be stacked on top of each other. This can also affect movement, and be part of puzzles. Some places are inaccessible unless the player stacks items to form stairs. A striking visual change is that the game world now takes up the entire screen in its original DOS environment, while previous Ultimas used a substantial portion of the screen for text, dialogue, buttons, icons, and the like. The game is the first in the series that is entirely mouse-driven, with optional keyboard hotkeys for some common actions. This is in contrast to earlier parts that were entirely keyboard-driven, and to Ultima V, which supplemented keyboard commands with on-screen command icons. While in Ultima V, the player has to specifically use a move command to move an item from place to place, or drop to drop it on the ground. In Ultima 7, items are simply dragged and dropped in their desired locations, while the game could be played entirely with a keyboard. Doing so is very difficult, and in-game characters would recommend the player use a mouse. Ultima 7 introduces graphical user menu pop-ups, GUMPs, which are on-screen representations of containers, later also used in Ultima 8 and IX. For example, clicking on a drawer or backpack will show the contents of the container on screen, allowing the items within arranged freely with the mouse. GUMPs are also used for books, scrolls, the spellbook, the status display, maps, and character equipment management. Double-clicking on the avatar opens his or her inventory, after which the inventories of other party characters can be opened by double-clicking them in turn. In Ultima 7 Part 2, Serpent Isle, the inventory view uses a paper doll concept. Equipping items will change the character inventory display to show the worn or held items in place. Another major change is that the game is now completely real-time, and only pauses when the inventory, the menu, or a dialogue is open, significantly affecting combat. The combat system was changed accordingly. Every party character is controlled by artificial intelligence AI, and the desired behavior can be chosen for each character. For example, stronger characters can be ordered to autonomously waylay your toughest opponents, while more vulnerable characters will keep their distance, and there is also the option to choose manual targeting for the avatar even when the combat is real-time and AI-controlled. Using items is still possible. For example, the game pauses while the player prepares to use an item from their backpack. The AI is capable of some astoundingly bone-headed, self-defeating moves, such as firing a triple crossbow into a crowd of allies, but it saves the player the need to micromanage up to 8 different characters in battle dialogue. In Ultima 7, taken in Exalt Ultima 7, The Black Gate is the first game in the mainline Ultima series to use dialogue trees. The first trilogy only allowed simple interaction, while the second trilogy used a keyword-based dialogue. Ultima 7 retains the old keywords themselves, but uses a dialogue tree where dialogue options are picked with a mouse rather than entered on keyboard. Previously, the Players had to learn a keyword from other dialogues, which allowed the player, if so desired, to find out the keyword from other sources such as walkthroughs. Now, the keywords only appear when they are actually learned beforehand in the game due to the plot. For example, thief caught dialogue option won't actually appear until a thief is actually caught. The game also features a lot more dialogue than the previous parts. Most of the characters have extensive dialogues. Game world. The game world of Ultima 7 is renowned for its interactivity. Virtually everything not nailed to the ground and not excessively heavy can be moved, taken, or interacted with in some way. It is possible, for instance, to bake bread, to forge weapons, to milk cows, to play musical instruments, to paint a self-portrait, and to change a baby's swaddling. The avatar and his companions, if not fed regularly, will complain of hunger pains and severe thirst, and will even perish if these matters are not attended to. Eventually, if they come across a disgusting or gruesome scene, they may groan and vomit. Sufficient intake of strong alcoholic beverages will also result in visible nausea. Ultima 7 allows free exploration of the game world, featuring a main plot and several other major subquests and tasks for the player to complete. It is a markedly open-ended game, where following the main plotline is inessential to the purposes of enjoyment, exploration, and character advancement. Once the player is free from their starting location of Trinzic, a walled city, the Black Gate is highly non-linear. Although there is a linear storyline, this is countered by the ability to explore the map in any order when coupled with the many sub-quests, including one that parodies Star Trek, The Next Generation, which was in wide syndication when the Black Gate was released. Ultima 7 features less emphasis on behaving virtuously than other installments in the Ultima series. The avatar can steal and murder to his heart's content, without making the game impossible to finish. However, the game simulated a society that sticks to some of the virtues. NPCs, either the party members or the people of Britannia, react to killings of innocents and stealing whenever they became aware of it. Party members may leave the group if they witness too much bloodshed and larceny and will refuse to join the party until the player redeems himself. They may even openly revolt and attack the avatar if he goes about committing wanton crimes incessantly. The guardian will sometimes appear and mock the player after they commit a criminal act. This makes sense in light of the final installment's revelation that the Guardian is in fact the alter ego, the subconscious mirror, to the avatar himself. The Black Gate features a deed system, where the avatar must purchase and carry a title to any horse and carriage or ship that he or she wishes to board. The Serpent Isle does not have this deed system. Instead, ships, barges, and the Serpent Gates are all triggered by the plot. The game begins with what appears to be the game introduction on the avatar's own computer screen. Suddenly, the screen is filled with static, and a red creature who calls himself the Guardian proclaims, "Avatar. Know that Britannia has entered into a new age of enlightenment. Know that the time has finally come for the one true Lord of Britannia to take his place at the head of his people. Under my guidance, Britannia will flourish and all the people shall rejoice and pay homage to their new Guardian. Know that you, too, shall kneel before me. Avatar, you, too, shall soon acknowledge my authority, for I shall be your companion, your provider, and your master." The orb of the moons glows, and the avatar finds that a red moongate has appeared behind the house. The avatar thus returns to Britannia through the moongate, and arrives in Trinzic, where he meets Yolo. Yolo tells him that 2 centuries have passed since he left. The whole town is shocked due to a ritualistic murder that occurred the preceding night. The body of the blacksmith Christopher was found in the stable. Finnegan, mayor of Trinzic, asks the avatar to investigate the incident in Trinzic. The avatar gets to meet several members of a new religious organization called the Fellowship. Eventually, in Britain, he meets Batlin, one of the founders of the Fellowship. He also meets Lord British, who urges the avatar to join the Fellowship, which, according to him, has done a lot of good things. It also turns out most of the mages of the realm have gone completely insane without any good explanation, and their magic doesn't work as it should. Most of the game is composed of the avatar's investigation of the Fellowship and the Trinzic murders. During the game, the avatar finds more and more clues that implicate the Fellowship in shady dealings. More murders appear on the way, and the avatar himself goes undercover by entering the Fellowship. His quest takes him to most of the cities and towns of Britannia, including Monok, a destroyed Skara Brae run by a lich, Yu, Moonglow, and Buccaneer's Den. The avatar eventually learns of an astronomical alignment of importance that is supposed to happen very soon, and about the 3 evil generators that the Guardian has created, which have been causing most of the problems of the land after destroying them. He and his companions follow several leads to the Isle of Avatar, where members of the Fellowship are waiting. The Fellowship has fashioned a black moongate out of blackrock on this island to allow the Guardian to enter Britannia. When the astronomical alignment happens, the Avatar confronts the Fellowship members and defeats them. As the astronomical alignment begins and the Guardian starts to loom behind the moongate, the Avatar destroys the gate just in time, preventing the Guardian from entering Britannia as the moongates had been rendered useless by the destruction of one of the generators. The Avatar has to remain in Britannia, with no means to return to Earth. Development elements of Ultima 7 are inspired by game creator Origin Systems' conflicts with competitor and later owner Electronic Arts. Origin Systems' corporate slogan was, "We create worlds," while the main antagonist of the story, the Guardian, is presented as a destroyer of worlds. The three evil generators created by the Guardian in the game took the physical shapes of the contemporary Electronic Arts logo, a cube, a sphere, and a tetrahedron. Elizabeth and Abraham, two apparently benevolent characters who later turn out to be murderers, have the initials E and A. The religious cult The Fellowship is inspired by Scientology. Richard Garriott also said it was inspired by the earlier computer role-playing games Times of Lore and Dungeon Master. Ultima 7 cost $1 million to develop. The game credits have been made to look as movie-like as possible, with all of the standard disclaimers and elements found in movie end credits. The credits, notoriously, also included the mention that a soundtrack CD is available from Origin, while it actually wasn't until 1993 as Origin Soundtrack Series Volume 2, Ultima 7 Part 2, Serpent Isle credits actually said soundtrack CD not available from Origin, so don't ask. Reception. Reception review scores. Publication score All Game 1925's Dragon GamePro 35/5 Award. Publication Award Computer Gaming World Role-Playing Game of the Year Nomination. Computer Gaming World Scorpia in 1992 praised Ultima 7, The Black Gates' first-class graphics, sound, and realism, called the story engrossing, and liked the mouse and keyboard-based user interface, but criticized the slow performance. I estimate that the slow speed of the game added about a week to my playing time, several serious bugs, and combat one of the least fun aspects of the game. She concluded that the game gives me very mixed feelings. Getting through this Ultima will require a certain amount of patience and forbearance. In 1993 she wrote that the game has its annoying aspects. It is certainly worth playing. Charles Ardai acknowledged the widespread sentiment that after 6 installments the Ultima series had been done to death, but argued that Ultima 7 is not more of the same. It is daring and unusual, has a sophisticated interface and story, takes full advantage of both its own history and the conventions of the genre, and manages to be at once grounded in tradition and unpredictable. Ardai praised the plot as the best in the series, stating that it is highly original, evokes genuine emotion, and serves as an allegory for problems in the real world. He also generally praised the game's puzzles, simple interface, and pacing. The magazine named it one of 1992's best role-playing games. Ultima 7, The Black Gate and Forge of Virtue were reviewed in 1993 in Dragon No. 191 by Hartley, Patricia, and Kirk Lesser in The Role of Computers column. The reviewers gave the game 4 out of 5 stars. GamePro gave the Super NES version a mixed review. They praised the gameplay interface and controls, but criticized the fact that monsters and chests respawn whenever the player leaves an area, pointing out that this allows players to easily accumulate massive amounts of loot simply by repeatedly leaving and re-entering a room with a chest. They rated the graphics and sounds as decent but unimpressive, and concluded the game to be nicely crafted fun. The Black Gate was listed as one of the 50 best games ever in a 1997 issue of PC Gamer, and ranked number 10 on their list of the 100 best PC games of all time in a 2011 survey. Forge of Virtue expansion box cover for Ultima 7, Forge of Virtue expansion, depicting the Black Sword. Forge of Virtue was an expansion pack that adds a quest to Ultima 7 in which the Avatar must pass a series of tests to revalidate himself in the three principles of truth, love, and courage, and destroy the last remnants of Exodus. With the expansion, an earthquake takes place at the beginning of the game. After speaking to Lord British about the tremors, the player will be given free use of a ship called the Golden Ankh, and can visit the Isle of Fire to begin the expansion subquests. The Isle of Fire was previously the site of Castle Exodus in Ultima 3, and reappears only during this game. The main plot of the subquests involves destroying the Dark Core, which contains the last remnants of Exodus. In order to do so, the Avatar must obtain three talismans of truth, love, and courage. coverage. By passing their respective tests, the concave and convex lenses from Ultima V are also required to complete the quest. The player is rewarded with a powerful weapon, the Black Sword. During the test of courage, the avatar also gains maximum strength, intelligence, and dexterity in the course of the tests. And after completing the quest, Lord British grants the player double strength on top of that. The Golden Ankh contains many extra supplies and the avatar can use it for the rest of the game, making it unnecessary to purchase deeds from shipwrights in later releases of Ultima 7. This add-on was always included. Reception Computer Gaming World stated that the expansion improved combat and other aspects of gameplay, as it only added a few hours of time to Ultima VII's estimated more than 200 hours. The magazine described it as sort of a cheat program mock a great game even better that made completing the main plot easier by giving players higher stats and powerful new gear versions and releases. The various parts of Ultima 7 have been published in at least the following forms: Ultima 7, The Black Gate 1992, the original release, available on 525 and 35 floppies. This release predates the ESRB, and as such, was not rated by them. The game credits do include the warning: voluntarily rated MP13 for mature players. Ultima 7, Forge of Virtue 1992, the original release, available on 525 and 35 floppies. Ultima 7 Part 2, Serpent Isle 1993, the original release, available on 525 and 35 floppies. Ultima 7 Part 2, The Silver Seed 1993, the original release, available on 525 and 35 inches floppies. Ultima 7, Complete Edition 1993 has both games and both expansion discs, available on 35 inches floppies. Only the Complete Ultima 7 1994 has both games and both expansion discs, on CD-ROM rated T for Teen by the ESRB for Animated Blood and Gore, Animated Violence, Electronic Arts CD-ROM Classics. The Complete Ultima 7 1994 budget release that has both games and both expansion discs, on CD-ROM aside of a brief installation and quick start guide, no printed documentation or trinkets, all documentation is on CD-ROM in PDF format. Ultima, The Black Gate 1994, the original SNES version, Electronic Arts CD-ROM Classics. The Complete Ultima 7, Gold Edition 1996, same as the 1994 release, but with gold-edged box in addition. It has been published as part of collections. Origin Top 10 pack includes Ultima 7, The Black Gate pre-EA buyout EA compilation, bundled with some Creative Labs sound cards. Ultima Collection 1996 contains all Cardinal Ultima games between Ultima I and Ultima 8, and also a Colobeth. The Black Gate was released in English, German, French and Spanish, included in the box like other Ultima games. Ultima 7 came with a trinket, a cloth map, and in Universe manuals the trinket was a triangle-shaped fellowship medallion. The cloth map was of Britannia. It included the fellowship book. It also included a demo disc for Ultima Underworld. Its expansion pack, Ultima 7, Forge of Virtue, included the Guide to the Isle of Fire pamphlet. Super NES FCI, Pony Canyon published the Super NES version of Ultima 7, simply titled Ultima, The Black Gate, which was created by a small team inside Origin Systems. This version is largely different from the original, since the PC version of the game was a then huge 20 megabytes, yet this translation could use only 1 megabyte of memory for all of the game data and program. The maps and many usable items and plotlines had to be redesigned from scratch, and the game program had to be rewritten entirely in assembly language. Citation needed. The game is largely real-time action, similar to the Legend of Zelda series. The party system was scrapped. Instead, the avatar journeys alone. Also, the story was largely changed in accordance with Nintendo's content guidelines. Instead of murders, the avatar is asked to investigate kidnappings. PlayStation Portable. In August 2006, GameSpot reported that Electronic Arts would be porting Ultima, The Black Gate, the SNES version of Ultima 7, to the PlayStation Portable as part of EA Replay. It was released in the United States on November 14, 2006. Compatibility with modern systems and fan projects. Both parts of Ultima 7 used a non-standard DOS memory management extension called Voodoo Memory Manager. This was not a typical DOS extender, therefore, Windows 9 95 and later are completely incompatible with the game in its original form. Unless rebooted into DOS mode, the game can be run with fan patches in modern operating systems. The game is also playable in x86 DOS emulators such as DOSBox. Exult as a cross-platform recreation of the Ultima 7 engine, which allows the game to be played on modern machines and across different operating systems. Exult's array of tools have enabled fans to take the game apart and modify it. For instance, for fan translation projects, Exult contributors have also expanded the game by enabling Serpent Isle paper doll graphics in Blackgate, and fixed some of the bugs and design flaws found in Serpent Isle, which were originally left in due to the rushed release. There are some features of the original game still to be implemented. For example, the way NPCs interact with the game world is not fully recreated, and some extra features added by the Exult team. The Exult project was noticed and positively commented by Richard Garriott. There have been a few projects to make Ultima 7 fan remakes in other game engines, but so far the majority of these projects have not been successful. GOGCOM has made the game available in a manner that allows it to work on modern operating systems, through a custom DOSBox installation references caret Urutima 7 za Barakuj to Matome, Fami Tong Com. Famitsu.com, the 22nd of February 2014, retrieved the 11th of March 2016. Carrot, the Trivial Ultima, Old Trivia Answers, retrieved the 29th of October 2006. Carrot, for clarity, it should be noted that the avatar character can be of either gender. Carrot, the Escapist, Issue 14, The Conquest of Origin, retrieved the 19th of July 2007. Carrot, Prima's Official Strategy Guide, Ultima Ascension, page 271. Carrot, Vintage Games, an insider look at the history of Grand Theft Auto, Super Mario, and the most influential games of all time, page 347. Carrot, Underworld Dragon audio collectible Ultima, retrieved the 2nd of October 2006. Carrot, AB CGW salutes the games of the year, Computer Gaming World, November 1992 p. Carrot, Underworld Dragon Ultima 7 collectible Ultima, retrieved the 25th of May 2007. Ultima 7 and Ultima 7 Part 2 on Origin, EA's Ultima Web Archive, The Conquest of Origin, background information on the Origin systems, Electronic Arts Conflict and Takeover, VE Ultima Series Main Series 123 IVV V77 Part 2 8X Worlds of Ultima. The Savage Empire, Martian Dreams, Ultima Underworld, The Stygian Abyss, Labyrinth of Worlds, Underworld Ascendant, Other Games, Akalabeth, Escape from Mount Drash, Ultima Online, Lord of Ultima, Ultima Forever, Quest for the Avatar, Cancelled Games, Ultima Worlds Online, Origin, Ultima X, Odyssey Developers, Chuck Beach, Dr. Cat, Richard Garriott, Warren Spector, David R. Watson. Other topics, characters, Avatar Lord, British Britannia Manor, Exult, Shroud of the Avatar, Forsaken Virtues, Ultima V, Lazarus VE, Origin Systems, Ultima Series 1, The First Age of Darkness 2, The Revenge of the Enchantress 3, Exodus IV, Quest of the Avatar V, Warriors of Destiny V, The False Prophet 7, The Black Gate 7 Part 2, Serpent Isle 8, Pagan Ix, Ascension Spinoffs Worlds 1, The Savage Empire Worlds 2, Martian Dreams Underworld I, The Stygian Abyss Underworld 2, Labyrinth of Worlds Online, Wing Commander Series, Wing Commander I 2, Vengeance of the Kilrathi 3, Heart of the Tiger IV, The Price of Freedom, Prophecy Academy spin-off, Privateer Armada on Earth spin-off, Strike Commander Pacific Strike, Wings of Glory Mobius and sequel Mobius, The Orb of Celestial Harmony, Windwalker Crusader and sequel No Remorse No Regret, Jane's Simulations Series, Jane's AH64D Longbow, Jane's Longbow 2 standalone games, Autoduel Ogre 2400 AD, Omega Tangled Tales, The Misadventures of a Wizard's Apprentice, Space Rogue, Bad Blood, Cybermage, Darklight Awakening, Bioforge Published Games, Times of Lore, Knights of Legend, Shadowcaster System, Shock Abuse, Cancelled Games, Ultima Worlds Online, Origin, Ultima X, Odyssey People, Brit Daniel, Chris Roberts, Chuck Beach, David R. Watson, Dr. Cat, Paul Nurith, Raf Koster, Richard Garriott, Warren Spector, Related Looking Glass Studios, Destination Games, Electronic Arts.